We all like to think that we are somehow self-determining, that we're in charge of our lives, and we're in command of who we are and where we're headed. For you young people, you'll learn that as you get older, you get less and less charge of your life and other things take over it. Believe it or not, right now, you're probably, when you're in college, if you're going to college, you'll be in the most control over your life. You probably will for the rest of your life. And having control of our lives is not a bad thing. Unless, like it does for some people, we can want this so much that we won't tolerate failure in our own lives. It is an insult to us. We can even come to see help as unwanted or undignified, something that makes you less, or your achievement less, so it's something to be avoided, kind of a last option, right? But I would bet that everyone, and I know that everyone in some way deep down, feels a little adrift in life, a little inadequate, a little helpless. We don't know where we're headed. We don't have all the answers, and we know our failures. The people of Judah at the time of the prophet Jeremiah vividly lived this reality of being adrift, helpless, and unsure of the future. In the time of today's reading from Jeremiah, the Babylonians were threatening Jerusalem with destruction. They would destroy it. The very existence of the kingdom Judah was ending for those people. The monarchy, the kings who were supposed to be their shepherds, or to shepherd them, had abandoned the Lord and had allowed the nation in many ways to descend to a dark place away from God. What was God's response to all of this? Hope. Hope. Listen to Jeremiah. Woe to the shepherds! I myself will gather the remnant of my flock from all the lands to which I have driven them and bring them back to their midst. God will be king and shepherd. He himself. So will a man be king and shepherd. Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, when I will raise up a righteous shoot to David. As king, he shall reign and govern wisely. God will be king of Israel through a son of David. It's a very sacramental paradigm, isn't it? An earthly reality will be a living, efficacious sign of the divine. Now, this prophecy fulfilled in Jesus, of course, we all know that. He's presented in the Gospels in a number of ways as the son of David. The blind call out to him, "Have mercy, son of David." Matthew's genealogy in his first chapter has three listings of 14 generations, 14 being the Aaron's son, and the Hebrew name David, Dalmeen. So Matthew's saying David in that genealogy. Jesus is the new David. Jesus is the righteous branch. Jesus is the fulfillment of the prophecy. He is the true shepherd. In Jesus, the Son of God, shepherds his people. And through his church, through his pastors, the priests, and bishops, Jesus sacramentally shepherds the church. In today's gospel, the 12 gathered around Jesus after he had sent them out to preach and to begin gathering those chosen by God to the new David, to gather what was scattered. And then they get into a boat, a symbol of the church, and depart for a place of rest. It's a movement away from chaos. It is a symbol of going out from the old to the new. The people have responded to the preaching, and they make haste to join them, to be with the new shepherds, and to be with the new David. Jesus is the good shepherd. He says it in John's Gospel, "I am the good shepherd." The good shepherd lays down his life for his sheep. He leaves the 99, and goes after the one lost sheep. What does this tell us about your shepherd, about God? That with the Lord God Almighty, with you, it is personal. God has come for you. God loves you personally, his concern is for you. His love and mercy goes beyond just a corporate love for his people. It is directed at each of us individually within his church, in the context of his church, but at each of us individually, who are more than just the face of the crowd to the Lord. And so often people cannot accept God's love. The shepherding is something for them, or even something that they want. Why is that? Any of you go to World Youth Day? Yeah, I think I've mentioned this before. But there I heard Cardinal Archbishop Tagle from the Philippines speak on this very issue. His Eminence talked about how our world is measuring human beings by their achievements, by what they can do, or what they can bring, or what they've accomplished. And how we even count our own worth and measure our own worth by our achievements. And so we don't tolerate failure. We cannot tolerate failure. It is an insult. It is degrading somehow. We tell ourselves, you can be what you want to be. And do it by yourself, because accepting help means that you don't really qualify as successful. You don't belong, you don't deserve to be included in that group. And so we protect ourselves from this danger by even sometimes running from the shepherd, because we think we have to be successful in order to be accepted by him. But we are really just protecting our pride. We deny our wounds, we deny our being lost, because it is embarrassing. It's not who we want to be. And we don't want help because I will lose my dignity, so leave me be. Let me fail. What's more, some think Jesus has so many good and holy sheep. Why would he care that much for me, wounded, lost, sick, or as a cardinal would say, dumb sheep? Why? Why would he care for me if I am not strong enough to live a holy life the way he's called? For the answer, I will quote His Eminence, the Cardinal. He says, we will ask the shepherd, who had 99 health, why look for me? Why love me? Why do you want to shepherd me? Why did you look for a sick, wounded, lost, dumb sheep? And the shepherd will tell you, yes, in truth, you are a wounded, sick sheep. But you are mine. You belong to me. The Father has given you to me. You don't have to prove yourself to me. You don't have to earn my love. Rather, let my love for you earn yours for me. We have a balance. Brothers and sisters, you belong to the Good Shepherd. We all belong to the Good Shepherd. In faith, all of us here, we're brought to him in faith by our parents or by our own faith that we have, and placed in the boat of the church with him. That's why this place looks like an ark. All the gurus, the geniuses, the charismatic leaders, all the pleasures and successes of the world, all our own efforts cannot shepherd us from death to life. Cannot give us lasting peace. Only he can. Only he can. Listen for his voice and trust that he loves you no matter what. And know that he truly is your good shepherd and wants to lead you and be a part of your life. That he is calling your voice to your name. And in the end, if you do that,